What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. Given a robot located at the top left corner of an N times M grid, we need to return the number of possible unique paths that the robot can take to reach the bottom right corner. To visualize this, take this grid as an example. The unique paths the robot can take to reach the corner on the other side of the grid are written in front of us, leading to a total of 10 unique paths. Keep in mind that the robot can only move either down or right at any point in time. No diagonal moves are allowed. Now, the easiest way to approach this problem is to break it down into multiple sub-problems. And the sub-problem here is to treat each cell as a destination for the robot. What do I mean by this? Well, what is the number of paths we can take to reach the cell on top of our actual destination, marked in green? And what about the one on its left, marked in blue? You see, since the robot can only move down or right, then if we manage to find the unique paths leading to these cells, all we must do is add them together to get the total number of paths we are looking for, right? Also notice how the starting cell of every path is either the purple or the brown one, and the ending cell is either the green or blue one. This logic can be applied on every single cell in a recursive manner. So, as an example, the total number of unique paths leading to the green cell is the number of paths leading to the pink cell added to the paths leading to the gray one. By applying the same thought process on every cell in the given grid, we will obtain the recursive diagram we see in front of us. This recursive approach can be easily implemented by making use of the exact logic we just discussed. All we must do is use the m-1 and n-1 values as our starting point and call the same method recursively by adding the number of unique paths leading to the cell on top of the current one and the cell to the left of it. Now, as with every recursive approach, this implementation is still missing the breaking condition. To come up with it, we need to take a closer look at our grid and try to see which parts of that grid this equation doesn't work on. And sure enough, this equation will throw an out-of-bounds exception for the first row and first column, as the -1 cell does not exist. To solve this, all we must do is add a condition to return 1 if we are dealing with either this column or this row. But why 1s? Shouldn't it be progressive? Shouldn't the first row, for example, look something like this? Well, no, it should be filled simply with 1s. As if we were to fill the first row incrementally, it means that there exist 3 unique paths that allow us to reach the green cell, for example, via its top cell. But we can see that this is simply not true. And the same applies for every cell in the top row of the grid. There is only 1 path that leads to each of these cells and it's marked in green. The same can be said about the first column. All the cells belonging to that column can each be reached via 1 path, the one marked in blue. Remember, what we are storing inside these cells is the number of unique paths which will eventually lead to the total number needed to reach the bottom right cell. Okay, now that we have grasped the main thought process behind solving this problem, let's try to optimize it. We previously discussed on several occasions the drawbacks of recursion and how we should make use of dynamic programming to write a more efficient solution. And deriving the DP approach for this problem is very straightforward. Since all we are doing is adding 2 cells together to give us the value of a third one, what we can do is create a 2D array and loop over every cell in the given grid with the help of 2 nested for loops. Inside the inner loop, we will make use of the same breaking condition we previously had. The value of the cell will be 1 if it belongs to the first row or column, and the value of the cell will be the sum of its 2 adjacent cells from the left and the top in any other scenario. The result returned to the user will be the value of the bottom rightmost corner cell. To reduce the space complexity of this implementation, we can make use of a 1D array instead of a 2D one. To do that, notice how all we need is the value to the left of the current one and the value of the previously calculated cell, which in a 2D array will be sitting either on top of it or in the previous row. But in a 1D array, it will be the value present in that same cell. So we can rewrite this logic by replacing the 2D array with a simple 1. The loops and conditions remain the same. However, the main change to be made is in the else clause. This new equation will be to add the current existing value, which in this case is the previously calculated one, to the value preceding it in the array. This will lead to the same output and same answers we previously had, and that's it. The link to the LeetCode problem we solved today can be found in the description below. Let me know your thoughts and suggestions for upcoming videos in the comments section. And that's it for today. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.